In this session, we'll be talking about economics and the investment markets, wherein our prime intention is to try and understand what is the fundamental connection that is existing between the prices of the financial assets and the underlying economy. How do I link the economic factors like GDP, inflation, how are these various economic factors, how are they really influencing the prices of the asset? So we are linking the economy with the investment market. So as a part of this session, the first part is to understand what do we really mean by the market value of any financial security. Here I could mean a bond, or it could be an equity security. In bond also it could be a government treasury bond, or it could be a corporate bond, or even it could be a real estate. For that matter, any kind of a financial asset, what do we really mean by the market value of that asset? Right, what is the generalized formula that we can very well use to arrive at or understand the market value of a financial security? Then we are going to look at the relationship. Various economic variables like growth rate, long-term economy growth rate, which is measured through the GDP growth rate, and what is the consistency or the volatility associated with that growth rate, and also looking at the different kinds of interest rates. How are they really influencing the market value of a security? We are talking about both the long term as well as the short term interest rates. Then in the connection of these interest rates, we will also look at the term structure of the interest rates, both for the treasury bonds as well as the corporate bonds, right? What does an upward sloping term structure mean? How does it relate to the value of the financial security? Then the same thing, how do I really look at the yield spread, especially inflation indexed or inflation adjusted bonds versus non-inflation adjusted? So more to index, inflation index linked bonds versus non-inflation bonds. So what is the kind of a spread between these two? How does the spread between these two bonds changes with the changes in the economy? When will the spread be more? When will the spread be lesser? That's another aspect that we are looking at. Similarly, the phase of the business cycle, right? The business cycle being an expansionary phase or a recessionary phase. How does this economic business cycle activity impact the credit spread? So when will the credit spread be more? When the economy is in an expansionary phase or in a recessionary phase? So bringing in the credit risk aspect, how does the credit risk change with the economic cycle? That's one more aspect that we are looking at. And how do these credit sensitive bonds or any fixed income instruments which are very much sensitive to the credit risk, how do they perform in different aspects of the business cycle? Then from the bonds and fixed income instruments, we move on to equity, right? And how does this equity risk premium change during the different economic scenarios? And what is it when we say consumption hedging property associated with equity? So does equity act as a good consumption hedge? Does it not act as a consumption hedge? So trying to understand that. And business cycle, how does it impact the valuation multiples? When I say valuation multiples, we are looking at price to earnings ratio, price to book value ratio kind of ratios, wherein we are talking about the market to the fundamentals. So those kind of ratios, how do they really get impacted because of the business cycles? Style strategy, growth strategy versus value strategy of investing, or large cap versus small cap strategy of investing. How does that change based on the business cycle? Which sectors or which particular style to go ahead during what phase of the business cycle? And finally, we are also going to see how does the real estate, especially the commercial real estate, get impacted by the various economic factors. So these are the various things that are coming as a part of this session. Let's move forward. When we talk about the market value of any financial security, first thing we need to understand is, when any financial security we talk about, it's a claim on the real economy. It uses the resources of the real economy. It produces something which could be beneficial to the real economy. So every asset price should be very much linked up with the real economy itself. So whenever we are using the word market value, we know it is nothing but the present value of the future cash flows. That is a very simple definition that we typically give for the value of any particular investment. So for the future, we are expecting the cash flows from each of the security. So we have to estimate the future cash flows that could be generated by each of these securities, then have a mechanism to discount. Have a mechanism to discount these cash flows to the present value. So which means the timing of the cash flows, am I getting this cash flow after 2 years or 5 years, is very much important, because the discounting factor will change based on the time period. Even the magnitude of the cash flows is very much important for computing the value of the security. So in terms of future cash flows, I am more concerned about the timing of the cash flows and even the amount, which is the magnitude of the cash flows. Then to compute the present value, I also require the discount rate. And what we know is discount rate is a combination of various things. The real default risk-free rate of interest, RF, is in real terms. Risk-free rate of interest in real terms, plus expected inflation. So these two put together should give me the interest rate in nominal terms, and all kinds of risk premiums that come up. Probably I call it as credit risk premium in case of a bond, maturity premium in case of a government security, equity risk premium in case of equity investment, or it could be a property risk premium in case of real estate. So some kind of a risk premium can get added up, which will determine the discount rate that we really need to use to arrive at the value of a particular security. And we need to understand this part will be impacted by the business cycle, depending on whether the economy is in a recession or in a expansionary phase. This will change, inflation could change, and all these premiums also could change, which means the discount rate that I am applying to arrive at the value of a financial security is very much impacted by the business cycle. Right? Now, the risk premium, this one, it is higher when there is a negative correlation between its future payoffs. So if you say a particular asset in the future, it pays off high and the investor's marginal utility from the future consumption is low. Means the negative correlation is existing between these two. So basically it is like, in the future I may lose heavily, but I need it more in the future. In the future there is a chance of losing heavily, but I want it more in the future only, not now. There is a negative correlation between the two. In the future the payoff is going to be, there might be a chance of losing more, and I really want more and more money in the future. So when there is a negative correlation between the future payoff and the kind of utility the investor is going to derive from using this particular asset in the future, when you see that the correlation is very negative, in that case I see that the risk premium is much higher. Right? So there is a possibility that I'll lose more, but I want more at that time, which means I'm ready to pay a high premium for that kind of a security. And when there is a positive relation, right, I want more in the future, and there is a chance that I will get more also. So in that case, it's a kind of a hedging. The asset is a kind of a hedging. So you obviously are going to get higher in future. So there is nothing. It's a hedge, and the rate of return could be much lesser than the risk-free rate also. So it could be a risk discount. It may not be a risk premium at all. But if there is no such relation existing between the future payoffs and the marginal utility from the consumption in the future, then we say that it is a risk-free asset. Hardly matters. Whatever I am getting in the future and whatever is the utility I am deriving in the out of consuming it in the future, there is hardly any kind of a relationship. Then that particular asset works out to be into the risk-free category. So that is the premier relationship that we need to understand between the future payoffs that we are going to get vis-a-vis the marginal utility for the investor from consuming that particular asset. Now, let's look at a different variant, which is the central bank's policy rate, right? Whatever the discount rate that is being used by the central bank for its as a part of its fiscal policy. So that particular policy rate, right, as a part of its monetary policy, whatever is the policy rate that we are talking of, it's a risk neutral rate. So it looks at what is the kind of growth in the economy, the GDP growth rate, along with the expected inflation. And this expected inflation may be market driven, or it could be fixed to a particular target. So whenever the bank's policy rate is coming up, it is based on these two elements. At what rate we are expecting the economy to grow, the GDP growth rate, and at what rate we are expecting the inflation to be present in the future. These two put together are actually contributing to the central bank's policy rate. Now, this particular inflation, it could be set at some particular target. Think of it like this. In reality, at this moment, if the inflation is greater than whatever the target, which means the policy rate will be higher than the neutral rate and vice versa. If the inflation is currently lesser than the target, so whatever is the policy rate, that would be lesser than the neutral rate. And similarly, when the output gap is positive, output gap is positive is actual output is greater than the expected output. The GDP, actual GDP growth is higher than the expected GDP growth. So then the output gap is positive. Even in that case, the policy rate will be higher than the neutral rate. So it would always be compared with respect to the neutral rate. And what we could see is that policy rate is primarily based on two factors. One is the economy's growth rate, which is the GDP growth rate, and the inflationary growth rate, which is any one of these increasing drastically compared to the other can very well lead to banks' policy rate being much higher. And we see that this particular rate is not constant, it keeps changing with time. So, to come out with a market value formula, we have a straightforward formula here. Look at the market value as the expected cash flows for each of the period. So period 1, period 2, period 3, period 4, period N. What are the expected cash flows that are coming out in each of the periods? What are the expected cash flows in each of the periods? I am discounting them with a discount rate. And this discount rate for all these, and after that I am adding it. And this discount rate typically contains three major elements, L, theta, and rho. L is basically with respect to the risk-free rate of return. L is with respect to the risk-free rate of return. So, whatever is the S period yield, on S more periods that are left for maturity in the same currency. So whatever is the yield to maturity that is coming on it is associated with L. And theta is more to do with the expected inflation between time period T and T plus S. Whereas rho is associated with the risk premium. Different kinds of risk premiums. So, for a bond, for a government bond, it could be a credit or maturity premium. For a corporate bond, it could be credit risk premium. For an equity investment, it could be an equity risk premium. And it could be property risk premium for a commercial real estate investment. So, these three components typically are used for determining the market value of any financial security. Now, this is where we'll start looking at first from the perspective of bonds or the fixed income instruments, which are primarily based on the short-term interest rates or long-term interest rates. So initially we'll look at the real short-term interest rates, then we'll move on to the nominal interest rate. Few interesting points here. The real short-term interest rates are positively correlated with the growth of the underlying economy. So which means if the GDP growth rate if the GDP growth rate is higher, I see that short-term interest rates are also higher for that particular economy. And similarly, we are also talking about a positive relation with respect to the volatility of the economic growth. So even if the GDP growth is highly volatile, if it is more stable, if the growth is more stable, the R could be slightly lesser, but if the growth is more volatile, even the R is, the short-term interest rate could be higher corresponding to that as well. So, an economy which is growing and that too with a high volatility, there is a good chance that the short-term interest rates are higher in that particular country. But if a country is not growing and it is consistent, then the short-term interest rates are much lower for that particular country. So an economy with high and volatile growth, you expect the marginal product of capital is higher. For one additional investment you do in capital, the output that is produced is much higher and much more volatile. So in that case, I can expect that the short-term interest rates are higher in that particular country. Whereas that particular economy, where there is no growth at all, and even that lower growth rate is very, very stable, even in those kind of countries, we see that the short-term interest rates are much, much lower. Then, you just see this. If the growth rate is much higher, which means the country is going to produce much more in the future, then there is no incentive for the investor to save for the future. Anyhow, I'll get this product in the future. There is a lot of production that is happening in my country. So why should I save for my future consumption? I'll spend it now. That will be the typical attitude. Now this is where, if I have to really promote the investors to save for the future, the only alternative is provide higher interest rate. If the interest rates are much higher, then there is a good chance that the investor can save higher for the future. That is where we are saying, if the GDP growth rate is higher, the interest rates in the short term are also going to be higher. And if we are talking about risk-free bonds, real risk-free bonds, only this real short-term interest rate will be the only factor that would be impacting it. Now, coming to the nominal interest rates, obviously it should be very much closely related to the central bank's policy rate, and it will comprise of the real interest rate, which is based on the savers as well as investors, along with the inflation as well. So the real interest rate is more to do with the growth of the economy, whereas even the inflationary changes contribute to the nominal interest rate. So the inflation, what is the level of inflation that is expected during the borrowing or the lending period, that is also one more factor that would drive the short-term nominal interest rates. So the real interest rate is influenced by the real economic activity, and expectation of the future inflation rates are going to influence, in additionally, the nominal interest rates as well. So you could clearly see that the short-term nominal interest rates are very much positively related with the short-term real interest rates, as well as the expectations of how the inflation is going to change during the period of borrowing or lending. So that's what on the short-term real and nominal interest rates. Now let's look at the corporate bonds. The term structure associated with the corporate bonds, right? Term structure is a kind of interest rates with respect to the maturity associated with the corporate bonds. So we know, again, it could be based on the short-term interest rate. Even if I'm talking about a long-term rate, we know that the long-term rate is a function of the short-term interest rates as such. So if you look at from the perspective of risk-averse investors, obviously the higher the risk they are planning to take, they need to be compensated with the higher returns for the higher risk taking, because they are risk-averse investors. which means the risk premium that they expect for that investment is higher. So as the maturity is increasing, every investment is subjected to maturity risk, and because of that maturity risk, higher premium is going to be expected, which means the term structure should always be a kind of a upward sloping itself. And even from an economic perspective, you see longer dated government bonds are less negatively correlated with consumption. Right? What I want to use in future may or may not be aligned with the returns that I am getting on the longer dated government bond. So they are not that negatively correlated, which means they don't form a perfect hedge. So because of that, they really attract a slightly higher interest rate compared to the short term ones. And the shape of the curve is primarily coming out with the short term interest rates as well as the inflation expectation. These two could be there even for nominal rate. But now that we are bringing in corporate bond, even the risk premium also is going to come up. And this risk premium, along with these two, are heavily influenced by the business cycles, depending on whether the economy is in an expansionary phase or in a recessionary phase, and how the policymakers are playing around with each of these interest rates. Now, just take for example, the yield curve is upward sloping. Now, what you could really understand, the returns to the short dated government bonds or short dated securities, they have more negative correlation with the bad time. Now you look at it, when the economy is very bad, the returns of short term bonds, right, if the economy has performed very badly, the interest rates have gone down. So the prices of the short-term bonds have gone up like anything because of the inverse relationship between the bond price and the interest rate. Economy has gone down, the interest rate has gone down. Because of that interest rate, obviously your bond price has gone up drastically. So the returns are very much positive. Economy very much negative. The returns on bonds are very much positive. And that difference, you will find very heavy negative correlation with respect to short-term bonds compared to long-term bonds. So that is why we see an upward sloping curve. During the short term, the interest rates are much lesser, whereas during the long term, the interest rates are going to be much, much higher. So we are looking at both rate at which the interest rates are growing, short-term versus the long-term, and even the risk part, the credit risk associated with the investment in the bonds, how well is it changing with respect to the economic business cycles. Then looking at inflation adjusted versus non-inflation adjusted bonds. So basically looking at TIPS, Treasury inflation protected securities versus the regular conventional government bond. That yield differential, whatever is the interest rate differential between the two, again is primarily based on how we are expecting the inflation to be in the future, along with the risk premium that could be associated with a security. If it is a corporate security, then the credit risk premium, or it could be a maturity premium in case of a treasury security. So the more and more we are uncertain about the inflation in the future, the more could be the differential between the inflation indexed or inflation adjusted securities versus non-inflation adjusted securities. And similarly, now bringing in the corporate bonds, wherein we are looking at the credit sensitivity of these instruments. So we are always measuring the credit spread. So credit spread is like a nominal spread, or it could be a zero volatility spread, which is a Z spread. It's basically, if I'm talking about a nominal spread, it's nothing but the yield on a corporate bond minus the yield on a government bond for the same currency and same maturity. And what we see is, when the economy is in a recessionary phase, is in a very bad situation, there is something called flight to quality or safety. So with this flight to safety, you can expect lot of investors pull out their investment in risky securities and move towards risk-free securities. So the demand for risk-free securities increases during an economic downturn, and the demand for the risky securities goes down, which means the yield between these two really widens when the economy is not doing well, because the probability of default could very much increase for the risky corporate bonds. But when the economy is doing well, no one is bothered, right? People are ready to take more risk. So because of that, the demand for risky securities goes up drastically, which will reduce the gap between the yield of the risky securities versus the risk-free securities. So depending on the business cycle, we see that the credit spreads also tend to rise as well as fall. So when the economy is not doing well, the credit spread can increase. When the economy is doing well, the credit spread is expected to decrease. Now, look at the credit spread narrowing. When will they narrow? When the economy is doing good, the spread is going to narrow. And here, people are least bothered about the credit worthiness of the instrument. Even when the economy is not doing well, this particular instrument can do decently okay. So the kind of importance they give to those bonds, to the credit worthiness of the bonds, especially when the economy is doing well, is almost negligible. So the rate of improving is much faster for those bonds which are having a poor credit worthiness compared to those bonds which are having, which are very highly credit worthy. Now look at companies' products. How are they impacting the credit quality? Look at those companies which produce the products or services extremely sensitive to the business cycle. Like we talk about real estate. Very extremely sensitive to the business cycle, right? When the economy is in a boom, lot of construction projects are out there in the market, and it would be vice versa when the economy is not doing well at all. So these kind of products and services are extremely sensitive to the business cycle. Whereas on the other side, look at a food industry or something, which is extremely insensitive. Or even when we talk about luxury automobile industry, very sensitive to the business cycle, whereas the regular day-to-day needs, education, hospitals, they are very much insensitive to the business cycle. So in this case, even when the economy is doing well or it's not doing well, the earnings are not that volatile, whereas here the earnings of the company are very much volatile. And it might so happen, when the economy is not doing well, it is always advised that you can sell off the shares of those companies which are very sensitive, sell off the bonds of those companies which are very sensitive to the business cycle, and you can buy or you can invest in those companies which are less credit, less sensitive or typically insensitive to these business cycles. So a cyclical sector with a low credit rating, both of them are negative. One is it's a cyclical, it is impacted by the business cycle. Two, it has a very poor credit rating. So if these two are there, the credit ratings, credit spread can really be abnormally higher when the economy is not performing well. They may even get a kind of a junk bond status, or their credit ratings degrade so much down that the spread heavily widens during the economic downturn. So that's how we can see the prices of the products being linked with the recession or expansionary phase of the economy. Then moving from the fixed income instruments towards equity, few important things which you all might already might be knowing. Equity, there is uncertainty in the cash flows both with respect to time as well as the amount. So by default, when I compare it with a fixed income instrument, in a fixed income instrument, at least I know the different timings. The timing of the cash flows are known in advance to a large extent, and even the amount of the cash flows is also known. Coupons at regular intervals and principal on maturity, all these kind of amounts as well as the timings are well known in advance. Whereas in case of equity, obviously none of these, neither the timing of the cash flow is known nor the amount of the cash flow is known. So because of those two, obviously the equity risk premium should be much higher compared to an equivalent credit risk premium itself. But look at when the economy is not doing well. We know that seniority of the payment wise, first it is that the lenders, creditors who are typically paid, and the residual is paid to the equity investors. So when the economy is not doing well, company is not doing well, probably the residuals will actually go down. Means there is a lot of uncertainty regarding whether the equity investor will receive their dividend or not. So because of that reason, one more factor that could contribute to the equity risk premium being much, much higher. When the economy is not doing well, the chances that the equity investor will lose a bigger amount is much, much higher compared to a bond investor, which means the equity risk premium should be even more higher. Similarly, consumption hedging properties are very poor. Means when the economy is not doing well, obviously I could see that the share price will go down. And when the share price is going down, I cannot use this to protect myself during the economy not doing well. So it does not pay off during the bad time. So when the company is failing, there is a good chance that the equity investor will lose a big chunk of his investment. So which means there is no advantage that the equity investor is getting because of the poor economy. So the equity risk premium and the credit risk premium, both of them, they are very much influenced by the business cycle. The bad business cycle, recessionary phase, even the CRP would be worse, ERP also would be higher. Both of them are going higher, which means the value of the financial instruments are typically going lower. The discount rates are increasing. The value of the financial security is typically worsening. So, investors should forecast the high growth rates in the earnings for cyclical companies, especially when they are coming out of the recession, because once the economy is coming out of the recession, again the cyclical companies are going to boom like anything, whereas stable companies might have a very small growth rate itself. So while predicting the cash flows associated with cyclical companies versus non-cyclical companies, even the investor should take utmost care in terms of projecting higher rates for cyclical companies, higher cash flows for cyclical companies, whereas the lower future cash flows for stable companies. Similarly, when I look at valuation multiples, when the economy is expanding more, people are ready to pay a high price for a $1 of profit the company has made. So the P/E should be much higher when the economy is doing well, and it might fall very well during the recession. Why will the P/E be higher during an expansionary phase? One, you will find the interest rates will be falling. When the economy is, when you are looking at high P/E, it could be because of the falling interest rates. Equity risk premium is falling because people really can't differentiate between investing in equity versus the bonds. So there is a high demand for investing in equity. Increase in the expectations of the future growth. Growth rate expectations are increasing drastically. And financial risk, operations risk, they are all coming down because these kind of risks are going to surface up drastically only when things are not going well. When the economy is doing well, none of these things come onto the surface clearly. So because of all these reasons, we see P/E to be much higher during an economic expansion phase compared to the recessionary phase. Similarly, strategy wise, look at a small cap stock versus a large cap stock. When the economy is doing well, people want to invest heavily in small stocks because they might give a much higher return. But when the economy is not doing well, even the small stocks can perform very, very badly compared to the large stocks. So which means small stocks are much more volatile compared to the large stocks. Small stocks don't have a diversified streams of earning. So there is a good chance they are very heavily affected by the economic cycles compared to large cap stocks. And even they can't raise capital also when the economy is not doing well, which could result in even further worsening of the small cap stocks. So the equity risk premium should be much, much higher for the small cap stocks compared to the larger ones. So the premium also during the recessions, it is going to increase compared to when the economy is really doing strong. And similarly, when we look at the commercial real estate also, you could look at it more or less similar to that of equity. The structure is more or less similar. It is not a hedge against consumption. Right? So similar to the market value of investment in the equity, the cash flows here I have to look at are the rent and the leases. Again, there could be a lot of uncertainty with each of these aspects. So which means the risk premium that is being demanded is much higher. Similarly, there is a lot of pro-cyclical nature associated with the real estate investments. So they have high risk premium. If I have to invest in those kind of properties, because when the economy is doing well, their prices are going to boom up. When the economy is into a recession, real estate is a sector that loses very badly. So again, bad economic outcomes, it is nowhere a good hedge. So that means higher risk premium is very much expected for a commercial real estate investment as well. And on the top of this, the property is very, very illiquid. And because of that, additional premium also might be very much expected from the investor if at all he has to invest in a commercial real estate property. So this is how we are linking the financial asset values with the various stages of the economic or the business cycle, almost the value of all the financial instruments get badly affected, get heavily impacted because of the changes in the economic cycle. So these two are very much interlinked, and a proper understanding of the relationship between the economic cycles and the financial values of the assets is very, very important. Thanks a lot for listening to this session. If you have any further queries, you can get back to me by giving me a call on the number that I have provided below, or you can send in an email at vamsidhar@pacegurus.com. Thanks a lot for listening to this session. Thank you very much.